Welcome back once again as we continue to celebrate a great night in New Orleans basketball history. February 25th, 1977, an incredible night for Pistol Pete Maravich, somebody that was on the opposition, joining us now, a basketball Hall of Famer, former MVP, three-time scoring champion, two-time NBA champion. And I remember when he came out and joined the Buffalo Braves, but we'll get to the Braves a little bit later. McAdoo, Bob, thank you for taking the time to join us. It was only 43 years ago, but I remember about that night at the Dome going up against Pistol Pete.
Let me tell you, that's a performance I will never forget. And the only thing I could tell them is, you know, when I look back and I remember that game, if we had a three-point line, I believe Pistol would have got 90 or 100 points because he was shooting them from everywhere on the floor. I mean, he was like almost 4 feet from behind the top of the key shooting in transition. He was getting layups. He was just all over the place. It was just an unbelievable performance. I'll never forget.
And that comes from a guy who was a scoring champion in 73. Yeah. Are actually 74, 75, 76, because Pistol then was the scoring champion in 1977. He shot 60% from the field that night. Tell us about, because he was also a threat as a passer. So when you were guarding him, or whether it was Clyde Frazier or one of the other guys, how did you game plan to defend Pistol Pete?
Well, we wanted to keep him from getting to the basket because we knew, you know, he was good, twisting his body, getting people in foul trouble, and we knew we had an all-league defender on him and Walt Frazier, but he just shredded Walt that night. It was like, you know, Earl took a chance at him, no go. Walt took a chance at him, no go. I mean, he just abused both of them that night. It was just no contest.
Well, let's talk about, you mentioned no three-point line. And you were a great shooter. You weren't a good shooter. You were an incredible shooter. And range as well. What about the range of Pistol Pete? Because I remember watching him, whether it was LSU early and then later in his career in the NBA, when he got to the Boston Celtics was the first year, his last year in the league when they had the three-point line, the 79-80 season. But what about his range?
His range was – it was almost like as soon as he – You had to guard him as soon as he got across half court because he could raise up 3-4 feet behind that the arc. And like you said, we didn't have a three-point line. And the corners was, you know, a joke for him. That was a small – the corners was my thing. I could hit from the corners. But when the three-point line came in, the shot from up top was – a little bit too far for me because I never practiced it growing up. And I'm sure he didn't either because we didn't have a three-point line, but he probably shot so much as a high school, college player, pro player that it was like a layup to him. I mean, he just rose up so easy with that shot. It was like a free throw for him. Just unbelievable.
It was amazing, his handles, his court vision, but – and then I heard the stories about press as Pete was growing up, driving the car on a gravel road, and Pete had the basketball out the window and he was dribbling while press was driving. I mean, a lot of guys couldn't use their left hand if they were righty, but it seems like Pete had every attribute when it came to handles as well.
Well, the thing about Pete, what was so amazing about him is the handle on him is the handle that you see on small guys like Tiny Archibald, Calvin Murphy. Pete was 6'5", and he had so much command on that ball. It was just unbelievable. I mean, transition was where you were really in trouble. Once they got the rebound and they threw it out to him, we always ran back to the lane to try to form a wall because we knew one-on-one, forget it. There's no way you're going to guard him. He's either going to hit the jump on you. If you pressed up on him, he's going to drive by you and make the shot or make a fantastic pass. He was just one-of-a-kind talent that I don't think the people, fans of today, realize what they miss seeing him at LSU and seeing him with the New Orleans Jazz.
What was it like playing in the Dome that night on February 25th, 1977? Because it wasn't like basketball was a regular thing in a Dome.
No, I mean, you know, most of the arenas, the people are, you know, cozy and down on you. Being in the Dome, it was like, we didn't feel like they had the home court advantage because the fans were so far away and it was so huge. And, you know, it was one of the games where, you know, many people came because, you know, New York, they drew right. Everywhere we went. I don't know what the attendance was that night, but I knew it was one of their most attended games to see us. But it was like a football stadium. I don't know how else you could say it. It was just so huge, you know, and the crowd, I mean, you didn't hear the crowd on you in a regular basketball arena like you would in the Dome.
I also want to go back to when you came into the league, you were with Jack Ramsey as your first coach in the NBA. Ernie D, Randy Smith, Gar Hurd. I mean, you were with one of the most entertaining teams I've ever seen in basketball, the Buffalo Braves.
Yeah, we were fast. I mean, that was our thing. We try to break people down, you know, with our transition game. And, you know, Jack Ramsey, he was really an innovator. He wanted us out and running because that was our talent. I was probably the fastest big guy in the league. And Randy Smith, even to this day, I've never seen anybody that could run baseline to baseline like Randy. Randy was an All-American soccer player at Buffalo State, a seventh round pick. He made the team and he had a great career also. I mean, his speed was just off the chart. We had Jim McMillan, who came from that championship Laker team that had won the championship and won 33 games in a row. Garfield came from the Chicago Bulls. You know, after my rookie year, after they saw my development, they changed the whole team up. They traded an all-star forward. They traded Elmo Smith. And I think we won about 22 more games that second year because it was just amazing. You know, I remember when I went to L.A., they called it Showtime, and I just kind of scratched my head. I said, our team in Buffalo was a lot faster than this team, but they didn't call us Showtime because we were in Buffalo. You know, it wasn't Hollywood.
Let me ask you this as well. Did you guys get to know each other? Because it was a different league. There weren't as many teams. Did you know Pistol Pete very well before you had to match up with him?
Not really. I guess me and Pete got pretty close because we played against each other. But I just remember being in school, watching him at LSU, and I put my hands on my head like, oh my God, look at this guy. He just, I mean, averaging 40 points a game. And then the guy I end up playing with, Earl Monroe, he was at Winston-Salem State. Those were the two guys you will never in college basketball see scores like that. I mean, Pete was averaging 40. Earl Monroe was averaging 40 at Winston-Salem State. I mean, those guys just went hog wild on offense. I mean, you just don't see that now, you know, with the players of today.
It's been an honor for us to have you here.
Okay. Thanks for having me.
And thank you very much, Bob. We are going to continue our look back on February 25th, 1977. And we're going to be joined by somebody that was not only in the building, but he was the official scorer. That's up next on Fox Sports New Orleans.